2016. How will these continued denials affect the Russia probe on Capitol Hill? Joining us now, Independent Senator Angus King of Maine. He is a member of the Senate Intelligence Committee. Senator King, thank you so much for being with us right now. Sarah Sanders at the White House says she's not going to address it at all. The fact that she said in August that President Trump did not dictate the letter, now his lawyer said they did dictate the letter. What questions does that raise to you?
Well, it certainly raises a question of what was the president's role in that particular episode. I mean, we're trying to keep our heads down on the Intelligence Committee and just work forward through this series of issues involved in the Russia investigation. So far, we've been able to deal with it on a bipartisan basis. I hope we're going to be able to continue that. But as we get to the tail end of the investigation, that's probably going to be a little more difficult. But, John, I continue to be concerned that all of the attention and focus on the collusion issue and what did President Trump do or say or sign or dictate takes away from the real underlying story, which is what the Russians did. Sure. And the fact that they're likely to do it again. And we're really trying to focus on that. We had an important series of meetings about a month ago on that issue and determined that, yes, indeed, the Russians were involved. Putin was involved. They were trying to tilt our election. They were trying to help mm-hmm. President Trump. And that is something that we've really got to focus on, because otherwise they're going to keep doing it and we're going to be vulnerable again.
No question about it. And your committee has put out many statements and many of your findings on just that subject. The question of the Trump Tower meeting gets to the idea of collusion. And again, I'm not asking you what's going on in your committee, because you guys have been pretty good at keeping secrets. But the fact that there was a lie spread about the president's response to that meeting. You know, this isn't just some meeting. This was a meeting at Trump Tower where Donald Trump Jr. Right. was promised dirt on Hillary Clinton. There was a lie spread about that the president did not dictate the response. We now know he did. Is that problematic for this White House?
Well, I think it is, but I think it's, again, I don't mean to be ducking your question, but that's really a question for the special counsel mm-hmm. who is looking into issues like obstruction of justice. Our investigation is about what happened in terms of the intelligence community and what we know about what the Russians did. Ours is a counter-espionage investigation, if you will. Obstruction of justice, that's in the lane of the special counsel. Occasionally our investigations merge, but in this case, they're really on two separate tracks.
I get that. Do you feel as if the people who have testified before your committee have been completely truthful with you?
Well, you're talking about interviews with something like 150 people, and completely truthful is a very high standard. We have no reason to think that there has been any significant misrepresentation, but there are some of the witnesses that we're hoping to recall to examine in light of later developments in terms of information that's come out.
Because we are getting some of the testimony from the Judiciary Committee, and we are seeing some inconsistencies there. You know, Donald Trump Jr. did testify again, and I'm talking about this because of the issue of truth, not because of intelligence. I know you're looking at intelligence, about sure. the issue of what the president dictated at the Trump Tower meeting. Donald Trump Jr. was asked, the Washington Post has since reported that your father was involved in drafting your July 8th statement. Is that correct? Donald Trump Jr. says, I don't know. I never spoke to my father about it. Donald Trump Jr. was asked, did you know who drafted that statement? He goes, well, there were numerous statements drafted with counsel and other people involved, you know, who opined. And he goes on to say that Hope Hicks may have been told something. But the idea here is we now know that's not what happened. The president's lawyers flat out said the president dictated the letter. That was testimony to a different committee. Does that testimony raise questions to you?
Well, it does, because it seems to contradict what we've heard just in the last few days from the president's own lawyers about what actually happened. And that was the word that was coming out. I mean, it does create problems, particularly because that testimony was to a congressional committee.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see if he does come back and try to clean that up at all, and if there are questions about perjury. Some Democrats are asking those questions. Chuck Grassley says it could just be a confused, muddled response. Let me ask you about North Korea. When sure. President Trump sits down next week face-to-face with Kim Jong-un, what do you want the president to get out of that meeting?
Well, the first thing I want to say is that I support the meeting. I believe the president's doing the right thing opening up this dialogue. That's the good news. The difficulty is, John, this is the fifth time we've been down this road with the North Koreans, and I think my counsel to the president, not that he's asked, would be to be careful and not make any commitments. Because in the past, the North Koreans have been willing to make commitments, which they've later just ignored, in the meantime, they get concessions of some kind. For example, a peace treaty, which has been talked about to end the armistice, call it a peace treaty, would be a win for North Korea. It would be an acknowledgement of North Korea, and that may be appropriate, but it ought to be in the context of a larger deal. So I'm just worried that the atmospherics of this historic meeting could sort of get us swept up into agreeing to things that ultimately aren't going to work. So I guess it's cautious optimism would be the way I would characterize.
If he comes out of that meeting without conceding anything to North Korea, but without getting anything back, without getting any you know, concrete, verifiable steps toward denuclearization, but if he comes out of this meeting with, say, just a meeting, is that enough? Is that worth it here?
Well, I think it's worth it in the sense that you're opening a dialogue that hasn't existed. We've had a lot of negotiations with North Korea. As I say, this is the fifth time. This is the first time we've had the national leaders in the same room. And if it just begins the process, and of course, China's going to have to be involved in this, and South Korea's going to have to be involved in this. Both of them have vital interests in what happens here. So this may be the first step, and I'm not going to criticize what I think is an important opening. The question is, what happens next? And I think the important thing is to also not get all excited and make concessions and do something in the spirit of the moment that then turns out to not be valid or useful and actually could be against our interests.
Senator Angus King from Maine, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks, John.
Allison?
Okay, John, you will remember this story. On Monday here on New Day, we spoke to Senator Jeff Merkley. That was right after he was blocked from entering an immigration facility where he believes up to 1,000 children are being held without